morning, friends, and welcome to Wednesday night prayer and proclamation. Well, I believe that very soon the church doors are going to be back open in this place, and we're going to be able to have some small groups meeting at this physical location. I'm believing God for it. I can't wait for that day. It's coming within the next week or so. I really believe that. For a while, we might have to shake hands like this, and I didn't realize, but I had my mask in my pocket here when I came in to record, and we might have to wear some of these masks, kind of stylish, right? But hey, whatever we have to do so that we can get back together, actually, we're going to come out of this time as blessed. That's my confession, and I'm sticking with it, because Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And as a church, we're going to emerge out of this, not only with the physical locations, but we're going to, by God's grace, keep hold of these media advancements that we've had so that we can keep hold of the people through media as well as the people here at the physical location. Well, we're praying that God has just given you all grace. I know that He is, but we're just praying that He's watching over and keeping you during this time. And I want to tell you guys, the light's at the end of the tunnel. We're trying to submit the government as best as we can, but not give up our First Amendment rights. So it's just about time just to throw the doors open and come back to church. But anyway, we know that God's keeping you during this time. God's keeping this place during this time as well. Well, if you got your Bible, could you go over to the book of Jude? I want to finish up a study that we started before the pandemic here, and we never got it finished. We were down to the last two verses, the best two verses, Jude verse 24 and 25. Now, if you don't remember because of all the stuff that's happened since then, or if you weren't even part of here for any part of that study, it really doesn't matter. These verses stand alone. They're just such a powerful doxology. Some people have called this the most powerful doxology in Scripture. Well, I'm just confessing this. You see, a doxology is coming at the end of a thing. And I'm just confessing this is the doxology of this season. Now, I know there will still be some ramifications of social distancing and so forth, but I believe that we're at the beginning of the end of this season. Can someone say amen? And that we're going to come into these new wonderful blessings of God. Well, let's go to Jude verse 24. He says, "Now to Him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you as faultless before His presence with glory and exceedingly great joy. To God our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forevermore. Amen." Well, as I've said, some people have called this one of the most powerful doxologies in Scripture. Jude starts out here by reminding us of God's ability. Friends, we always need to remember God's ability. He is able. Unto Him who is able be the glory. There's nothing too difficult for God. What is impossible with man is possible with God. Oh, I'm telling you, God is able to do anything. What is the need in your life today? God is able to meet that need. All of the names of God describe Him as a God that is able. He's a God to do exceedingly, abundantly, beyond all that we could ask or think, the Scripture tells us another place. You see, we don't have some little shelf God. We don't have some little idol that we set on a shelf, you know, and we carve the wood and we give it a nice smile, or we give it a nice frown. If you're an introvert or maybe a Norwegian, you give it a frown and you put your little idol up on your shelf. And the book of Isaiah said it's so foolish, because you take the block of wood and you cut it in half and you put half of it and you warm yourself and you cook your meal, and then the other half you carve your little idol and you put it on your shelf and you worship it. But it's blind, it's deaf, and it's mute. See, maybe in America and maybe in what we call the advanced world, we've gotten a little bit more sophisticated, and our idol may be other things. It might be wealth, it might be family, it might be popularity, it might be media, it might be work, it might be a car. It's funny, you can worship anything. okay, maybe a literal idol. You can worship anything, but those are puny gods. Those are false gods. Those are little idols that have no power. But friends, we don't serve an idol God. We serve a God who is able. We serve a living Lord. I mean, do you remember when he rose Lazarus from the dead? Lazarus was dead for 4 days, and it said that his body even stunk, and he was all wrapped up in the cloth, and he was put in the cave. And Martha, she had a good confession. She said, "Lord, I believe that you'll raise him up at the last day." But Jesus said, "Martha, don't you realize that I am the resurrection and the life? I am the resurrection and the life." Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. And nobody comes to the Father but by me." Friends, I'm so glad that we don't serve an idol God. I'm so glad that we don't serve a God who's dead, or a God who's deaf, or a God who's mute, or a God that can't speak to our needs. But we serve a God that is able. And this is how Jude begins to close this wonderful book. He says, "Now unto him who is able." Now see, you got to remember a little bit what the book was about, the book of Jude. Jude took on a lot of things. He took on false teachings, and he took on false teachers, and things that had crept into the church, and things that were hindering and deceiving the people of God. But then he comes to the end and he says, God is able. You see, because the real story of Jude isn't, of the book of Jude, isn't the deceiving teaching or the deceiving teachers, but it's that God is able, even through that mess, to keep his people. God is able, even through that mess, to give discernment to his people. Friends, we need to remember that we serve a God that is able. We can quit looking to dead idols. We can quit looking to self-effort. We can believe the Lord Jesus, who's the living God. He's the risen God. He specializes in miracles. He specializes in impossible situations. Our God's not dead. No, he's alive. Come on, somebody. And he's alive and he's able to meet every need. Do you remember when God revealed himself to Moses back at the bush, the burning bush? And God said that his name was I Am. Now, what I Am meant, that seems pretty open-ended. But if you look that up in the Hebrew, God said, I am. He was saying, Moses, I am whatever you need. I'm able to deliver you, the people from Egypt. I'm able to use you in spite of your stuttering and your past. I'm able to make water come out of a rock. I'm able to make bitter water sweet. I'm ready and am able to destroy the enemy's armies. I'm able to keep a people in the wilderness for 40 years. You see, when he said, I am that I am, he was saying, I'm a God that is able. I'm a God that's always with you. I'm a living God. You see, Jude echoes it here, and he says that God is able. Now, unto him who is able. I don't know about you, but sometimes I feel my abilities are so weak. They're so wanting. And we see that God is able. Actually, I'll tell you, recently I've had any number of dreams. And I've been praying for God to help me to interpret those dreams, because I feel like, to a very large degree, dreams are the language of God. The Word says that he speaks to us in the night. And he's been giving me, I believe, the ability to understand and discern many of the dreams that he's given me in my sleeping hours. And as I've thought on those dreams and interpreted those dreams under the power of the Holy Spirit, what I've come to find out is that there are dreams that always remind me that God is able to do it. For instance, I'm not going to give you specific dreams right now, because I don't want to take the time for that. But basically, in each of these dreams that I had, several of them, I would find myself in a complex situation. In one place, there were these big math problems, and I couldn't solve them. But then God simplified and solved the problems for us. In another place, I was working in an office where I didn't have the knowledge to work there. It was like there were all these legal books, like books behind me, but they were these big legal books, and I didn't have the knowledge to know what book to get off the shelf or how to read all the legalities, all the details. I'm not good at that. And yet, in the midst of that, God gave me the answers I need. Well, the message is very simple, that in spite of my lack of qualification, I serve a God who is able. Can somebody say amen? I mean, I'm going to tell you something, friends. I'm not a doctor, but I serve a God who's able to heal all of my diseases. I'm not a pope. I'm not a holy man, but I serve a God who's able to forgive all of my iniquities. Can somebody say amen tonight that we serve a God who is able? He said here, unto him who is able to keep you from stumbling and present you as faultless before his glory. He's able to present you as faultless. Now, I'm not going to talk a lot about this because it's one of the very backbones of the proclamation that I make in the Word, is that God's righteousness has been made ours through Jesus. We've been made right with God. You see, we're able to stand because of the righteousness of God. He's able to keep us from stumbling and present us as faultless. I don't think there's a person that can watch this video and say that I'm faultless. If you've ever met me, I'm not faultless. I mean, I'm a cracked pot, man. I'm a failed vessel. But yet, in the midst of that, I'm able to be kept by the power of God. I'm able to be faultless. If I may not be faultless in my actions, but I'm faultless because of the imputed gift of God's righteousness. It said in Isaiah 61 that God actually put the garment of salvation upon me, that he actually put over our shoulders the garment of his salvation. God makes us faultless because of his grace. Only God can do that. That's incredible. Only God could remove our sins from us as far as the east is from the west. But he's a God that's able. Now, part of what this is telling us is he's able to keep us from stumbling. He's able to help us in our walk. And I'm going to tell you, the only thing better than forgiveness of sin is the sin that I never committed. Can somebody say amen? I can look back and I can see a lot of foolishness, stupid decisions, sins that I committed, that God turned them for good, God worked them out. But I can tell you, the best situations are the ones that I never sinned in, that he kept me, that he spoke to me, that he gave me wisdom, that he put me here, or that he put me there. Well, I'll tell you, I'm not going to go deep into this, but there was a property that I was looking at very strongly. I was thinking about buying the property, and I wasn't sure what to do on that, and then this pandemic hit. Now, I won't buy or not buy property because of a pandemic, but in said case, in this circumstance, God showed me through this that it wasn't his timing and it wasn't his will for me to have bought this property. And I said, thank you, God, that you kept me. Because I could have bought this property and I could have been sitting on this debt. I could have been sitting on this problem, but God kept me from it in this season. Now, there's another season he might say buy property, but in this season, he kept me from it. You see, God has wonderful, powerful keeping power. He's able to keep us. He's able not just to deliver us, but to keep us from stumbling. Now, one of the things that's important for this is that we be in Christ. The promise is to those that are in Christ. And I want to go over to John chapter 15, just really quickly. And I want to read some verses here. That's dangerous stuff, because I'll tell you, we read these and there's a sermon in every verse. The Word of God is inexhaustible. But over here in John chapter 15, excuse me, he talks about Jesus being the true vine. And we'll just read a few verses. Verse number 5, Jesus talking says, I am the vine and you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him will bear much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered. And they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you may bear much fruit, so that you will be my disciples. Jesus is telling us there that the key to fruitfulness is being in him. The key to the key to thriving is abiding. When we're in Christ, God will keep us. When our righteousness falls short, which is all the time, God's righteousness takes over. When our ability falls short, our God who is able takes over. Friends, we can stand in faith with God. We don't have a little God. We have a big God. I've said it so many times, and I heard another preacher say it years back, that if you serve a little God, it takes a big faith. But if you serve a big God, it only takes a little bit of faith. You see, friends, our God is able. He's able to keep us. He's able to present us as faultless. before his presence with exceedingly great joy. Now, I don't want you to miss the end part of that where it said that it's with exceedingly great joy. And I want to go over here into the book of Psalms to Psalm chapter 16. Psalm chapter 16. Give me just a second to get there. The last verse, verse number 11, it says, "You will show me the path of life. In your presence is the fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore." See, in his presence is the fullness of joy. He's able to keep us in his presence and in the fullness of joy. At his right hand are pleasures forevermore. Now, we need to understand something. God is infinite. He's all-powerful, all-knowing, all-merciful, all-loving. He's God, man. We use illustrations, but we can't wrap our mind around who God is. But the word here tells us that for the believer who's in Christ, this is not for somebody that you're hoarding your sin. It's not for somebody that's outside of Christ, but for the believer who's resting in confidence in the finished work of Jesus, we're told that in his presence is the fullness of joy. Now, do you remember that, I know you do, probably one of the most famous worship songs ever. I can only imagine what it'll be like when I see him. Well, friends, sometimes I've thought, I wonder what it'll be like. And sometimes we think that we're going to stand before God and we're going to be in a tear. Ah! No, not for the righteous. Now, there is a holy awesomeness to God's presence. It's awesome. God, he's an awesome God. But it tells us that if we're in Christ, that in his presence is the fullness of joy. Now, some people feel like if you get into God's presence, it's all about doom and gloom, fire and brimstone, repentance. Some good Christians believe this. They believe that, if we start to worship the Lord, this terror is going to overtake us and this holy awesomeness of his presence. Now, I want to say this very clearly. There is that aspect of God, but that is the doorway aspect of God. That is the doorway. Okay, because when we come into God's presence, we must be cleansed. We must confess. We must, trust in his righteousness. So there is an aspect of when we come into God's presence, a terror. Paul said, "Wherefore, knowing the terror of God, we persuade men." There is a holy aspect of God. I'm not discounting that. But I'm telling you that that's the doorway. When we've been cleansed, when we've repented, when we've stepped through the door, we get into the grand ballroom of his presence, the mansion of his presence. And in his presence is the fullness of joy. And it's in the joy where God wants us to abide. God wants us to abide in his joy, where at his right hand are pleasures forevermore. Now see what parallel in this with Jude, what we're being told here. He's an awesome God, but he's also a God who's able to keep us. He's a God that's able to restore us. He's a God that's able to bring us into his presence, and where anyone without him would feel terror, we can come into his presence and feel the awesomeness of joy, the awesomeness of love. Oh, that's good promises. That's good stuff for the people of God. Hold on to. Now, look what, and by the way, he said it was exceeding joy. And we could go over to Peter, where Peter said it's joy inexpressible, all full of glory. Well, but look at verse number 25. He focuses on attributes of God in verse 25. Now, this is what, dear God, that you would help me to never forget this, and that you would help me to never stop proclaiming this. Okay? It's all about looking at Jesus. We should only look at our sin long enough to repent of it. I did not say we should not repent. We better repent. But we better only look at our sin only till we repent. But we better look at Jesus always, because he's the author and the finisher of our faith. And like the old song said, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full into his wonderful face. Oh, come on, somebody. And it says here, see, Jude leaves us by looking at Jesus. And this is where it's at. If we look to the world around us and the storms, we'll get swept away. If we look inwardly too much at ourselves, we'll fall into depression and helplessness. But when we look up to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, then we find liberation. We find the fullness of joy. We find His ability working in us and the ability to say, oh, it's a wonderful place to be, looking unto Jesus. Well, look at verse 25. Jude does that. He focuses on the attributes of God. He says, to God our Savior. Oh, come on. How many of you are glad that God is our Savior? He didn't have to save us, but He is our Savior. Sometimes you feel like, God, do I got to keep bringing the baggage? And He says, well, yeah, because I'm your Savior. I came to save you. That's His mission. He's the Savior. There is no other. There is no other name under heaven whereby men can be saved. Aren't you glad that God's love is so unconditional that He's the only God that can know everything about you, every down to the slightest motive of the heart? Every wicked thought, every wicked action He knows, and yet He loves you unconditionally, and He wants to save you unconditionally. That's a good Savior that we got there, the best of the best. It says, He alone is wise. Aren't you glad that we got a God who's willing to share His wisdom? Because it said in the book of James that if we lack wisdom, that we can ask God and He would give it to us liberally. You see, that's right along with the dreams I was sharing about you about a few minutes ago. You see, I was in these situations where I didn't have the knowledge base I needed, but God gave me the wisdom so I could stand, so I could perform, so I could overcome. He does it. He gives wisdom liberally. He's the God of all wisdom, the God of all knowledge. And if we'll only ask, He'll pour it out upon us in every situation. It says, unto Him be glory and majesty. How many of you are glad that He's the King? Majesty. We worship His majesty. Jesus is the King. And we have to learn to enthrone Him on our heart, that He'll not just be the Savior, but He'll be the Lord. It's learning to submit to Him, to trust Him, but also remember that all majesty has all dominion and power. See, I love the word dominion, because it speaks of the fact that how the Lord has put all of His enemies under His feet. There's not a demon in hell with all of its echelons right up to the devil himself that can resist the people of God, because the God of all dominion stands with us. The name of Jesus is the name above every name. It's the name above every dominion, above every power. Oh, dominion. You know, in the word dominion meant the kingdom. You know, the whole vastness of the kingdom. Well, some people have dominion in certain areas. You know, some person, you know, I think about this, someone might teach English, but they might not be good at a lick of math. And so they have great dominion in English, man. They're an English expert, but you try to give them math, they can't hardly do the arithmetic at all, you see. But God has all dominion. He's not good at one thing or bad at something else. I don't care what it is. I don't care if it's rocket science. I don't care if it's babysitting. I don't care if it's demonology. I don't care if it's Christology. God has all dominion, and He's the expert of experts. And not only does He have dominion, but it says here that He has power. It's not just theory. I have a hard time with things that are just theoretical truth. I mean, because we can all day long sit around and discuss the theory. I mean, I just struggle with that. You know, we can pull out the books of academia and say, well, brother, the theory of Christology says this. But friends, we got to get it practical. There's got to be power to bring it to pass. God doesn't just have, it's not a theory of God. He's a person with power. He has dominion, and He has power, and He has authority. That's dunamis power, dynamite power, the ability to release mightily in our life to bring us the breakthrough that we need. Not just the authority to do it, but the power to do it. And it says that authority, that dominion, that power, that saving, that it lasts both now and forever. It's never going to come to an end. We're never going to be without Jesus if we'll just trust Him, if we'll just remain in Him. Friends, some of you may have been in isolation. You may have been in quarantine, but you were never alone. Yea, though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, His rod and His staff, they will comfort me. Yea, it says in the New Testament, yea, I'm with you to the very end of the age. I'm holding your hand, the Lord says. You see, we're never alone. Well, friends, I know that the word was a little bit longer today, but I want you to proclaim it over your life. I want you to proclaim that I'm able to stand because of the grace of God. And when I'm fallen, I'm able to be picked back up because of the grace of God. And I want you to begin to turn your eyes to Jesus now and off of yourself. Let's pray. Father, right now, we release the gift of Holy Spirit prayer language in the people's lives right now. If you want it right where you're at home, lift your hands. Now, some of you have it and you need to be refreshed. The gift is there, but we refresh it right now. We open up the fountains of the deep. We pull the lid off of the well, and we dip into the wells of salvation. Come on, pray in the Holy Ghost, saints. Pray if you got the gift. Sola kariate, underesota kariate. Some of you can receive the gift right now. Right now, pray. And I want you to pray this. I want you to pray that believers would activate the gift that's in their life. Father, do it. I pray that you would wake people up. I pray that you would re-energize the gift, that you would refill, give a refilling of the Spirit, Lord God, a freshness of the gift, Lord God. I pray that Pentecostal churches would become Pentecostal once more, and non-Pentecostal churches would become Spirit-filled, Lord God, that the power, the same power that raised Christ from the dead would be working. Father, I pray right now that you will work, Lord, in every home, Lord, that the power of God would be there, that the dominion of God would be there right now. I want you to decree right now. This is prayer and proclamation. And actually, what we're going to do tonight is, instead of me praying over the camera a lot, we're going to turn it off a little bit early. And I want you to spend at least 15 minutes in prayer with your family. Okay? I'm not going to tell you how to do it, but take at least 15 minutes in prayer with your family tonight, if you could do that. It would be appreciated. I'm going to stop this 15 minutes early. And the last 15 minutes can be prayer with your family. But I want you to decree these things over yourself. I want you to say that God is my Savior. Oh, come on. Even if you know it, you ought to decree it. In other words, I don't got to deliver myself. Oh, the angel of the Lord is encamped around about me because I fear him. God is my Savior. God is my deliverer. Come on, someone. Declare it. Declare it that God is wise and he pours his wisdom out on me. I'm not foolish. I'm not a fool. I'm not stupid. I'm not without qualification, because the God of all wisdom has poured his wisdom out upon me. Go ahead, pray it right now. If you're a student, you can pray it. The wisdom of God will come. All the knowledge of the studies will come back that you've studied. You can pray for the wisdom of God in the decisions that you're making in business and in home and in family and in church. Pray for the wisdom of God to flow. Say, the wisdom of God is mine. The wisdom of God is mine. I take it. I want you to pray that the glory of God would fill my life. Oh, I mean like that inexpressible something that I walk around and the presence of God just goes with me, that he does things that I never asked him to do because the glory is upon me. Say, the glory of the Lord is risen upon me. I want you to declare that he's king of my life. I declare the majesty of Jesus over my life, over my family, over this church, over those that are listening to this video. We declare the majesty of God. He's king in our home. Doubt isn't king. Fear isn't king. Unbelief isn't king. Sickness isn't king. Sin isn't king. Jesus is the king of this home. We declare him to be king. We declare his dominion, that he reaches into every nook, every cranny, every corner, that his power is all sufficient over our life and over our home. We declare his power, that it's not just theory. I would say, I receive the power of God right now. Power of God, come right now, we pray, and he'll be with us both now and forever. Oh, satala kariate, undera kandere asha. May the blessing of the Lord be upon every house. The blessing of the Lord be upon every saint, in Jesus' name. Now, friends, I'm going to trust you to do your assignment, please. Take 15 minutes with your family, and I want you to pray. Now, we're not going to tell you how to pray, because the Holy Spirit will speak to you now sovereignly. We've decreed it. We've proclaimed it. We have the wisdom of God, the power of God, the dominion of God, and we know that he'll be able to answer everything that we present to him in Jesus' name. So now, as we turn off, let's take this time to pray together. And also, my commitment to you is that if you have a specific prayer request, leave it in the comments below this video, and I promise you that I'll pray with you. Okay? Be blessed, and I'm believing that very soon we're going to be meeting back together here. Okay, we'll be praying together for the next few minutes, even though we're not seeing each other. God bless, friends. Good night.